change impacting the education sector are perhaps unparalleled. There are demographic trends of new generations entering the classroom, combined with the challenges of attracting and retaining younger staff amidst an ageing of the profession. Added to this, of course, are technological changes and transformations, social changes, funding challenges, and global influences. So joining me today to unpack some of these trends shaping the future of education is McCrindle's founder and principal, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Great to be with you.
I know that you are a big fan of the education sector because we've been running this annual Future of Education report and research ever since I've been involved with the organisation. I know that you are really passionate about helping and equipping that sector with research-based insights, and you do a lot of keynote speaking and advisory to different boards and teachers and PD days. Mark, can you give us, or our listeners, a bit of an overview of what you see as being some of the most significant trends currently shaping the future of education? I mentioned and I rattled off a few of those mega trends in that introduction, but what do you see as really shaping the future of the sector?
Well, a lot of change coming, and not just technological change to education. It's a sector dealing with growth just as the population grows, and indeed as class sizes get smaller. There's the need for schools to grow and adapt, and we've got 10,000 schools in Australia and more than 4 million school students, and obviously that's replicated globally in terms of schools and students and that growth. But you've got growth in the sector in terms of different types of schools emerging. It was once thought of as pretty much government run, but in Australia, 1 in 3 students goes to a non-government school, and that's actually growing. They're growing faster in enrolments than the government sector. And you've got growth in terms of the types of schools. Parental choice is driving some now to look for even online schools, which is a growing trend. You've got demand. We found the majority of parents say they support schools to provide choice, such as single-sex schools and religious schools. In fact, the faith-based non-government schools are one of the fastest growing sectors. You've got special needs schools and schools in geographical areas offering better access to those that might be living there. And as our population shifts and we see regional growth, we see schools setting up there. And we've got a focus on, from a parent perspective, on schools that offer holistic education, that are developing not just numeracy and literacy in their children, but looking to grow them in leadership and communication and life skills and job readiness skills. And probably a broader trend as well is just this trend towards lifelong learning. It's not just school, but education begins in the preschool years now, with the majority of children having some form of pre-kindergarten engagement with a childhood educator, maybe through childcare or prep. And then the majority of students after year 12 in Australia go on to tertiary training of some form or other. So education is a larger proportion of life now than it's ever been before. So yeah, massive changes in so many different areas driven by, you know, these various trends.
And it was interesting. I was looking just earlier today, actually, at our education Future report, which is all about building thriving schools. And it was interesting, like you mentioned there, just the growth in the non-government schools. I mean, of course, government schools still comprise the majority of schools in Australia, but that non-government sector is growing. And it was interesting to see within this report, we were able to filter through some of the questions based on non-government school parents compared to government school parents. And just, of course, as you mentioned, with more diversity, even in the types of schooling, you get more diversity in parent perspectives and parent expectations and even what influences their decision to send their children to their school. It was really interesting to see just some areas were quite similar across those different groups of parents, but others around like location and affordability and even the quality of the educational program, there were some key differences there. So I guess with this more diverse range of schools, types of schools, there's just more nuance, which is all of this, like you said, increasing complexity that we're seeing in the education sector today.
Yeah, totally. And schools have grown in their importance in that they are one of the few social mediating organisations. They stand at the crossroads of our community to develop children and young people and to take the burden from parents in supporting those parents in developing that next generation. And they used to be supported more by youth development organisations that were a lot more visible in our community. scouts or maybe sporting clubs or service clubs, churches, Sunday schools, religious organizations. Not as many of those are as visible, or indeed not as many people pass through those organizations, but schools are still there as the social bottleneck through with which most children will pass and pass for an increasing period of time, as I said. So, you know, they have that important role, and teachers and school leaders have that important role, not just in their schools, therefore, and in their school communities, but in the broader community as well. And so these are big changes where the government and society relies more on schools to ensure that this next generation are being trained up and equipped in a broad array of areas, not purely the three R's of reading, writing, and arithmetic.
Yeah, and I guess like any change that we're seeing take place over time or trend, there's both really cool aspects to that, and I guess the positive part of me is like, wow, like how great is it that schools can play this role for people and help them to be part of a community and thriving. But I guess I also consider then the challenge maybe, and I can imagine for school leaders and principals and teachers, they're like, gosh, the pressure's just there that we're not just expected to educate kids but now be all these other things for them. Would you say that they're some of the impacts that we are seeing, I guess, of these changes in terms of even the expectations that we place on like educators and schools today?
We do place a lot of weight on their shoulders, and this can be quite the cause of stress for teachers and school leaders. You know, it's almost as if parents are busier than ever and they're outsourcing more of the child rearing to other entities in society, and you've got the government saying, well, we've got a problem around maybe this ethical area or water safety or road safety or animal welfare, let's teach that in the schools. And so more and more gets added to the school curriculum, and that curriculum creep, as it's called, you know, further creates time challenges for the teachers. And we found in our research, as you know, Ash, that there's burnout amongst teachers and less of an engagement in the profession, shorter tenure, or at least a rise in the proportion that are thinking of leaving, have actively considered leaving the profession because of the extra requirements, paperwork, bureaucracy, expectations, challenges placed upon them. So getting that right is key. And if we're talking about a sector that's growing with more schools and more students and more expectations from parents, then we need to ensure that there's a good staff pipeline of teachers and support staff coming through. And attracting and retaining staff is a really key challenge now for the sector, because there's the need for more teachers than ever, but at the same time, they're not staying in terms of career for life anymore. And there can be other opportunities that they find are really desirable for a second career or a third career. And so retention of staff and even bringing them in the first place is a real challenge.
Yeah, I think it's interesting that you highlighted that, because I know, well, not interesting because we saw it in a research last year, but probably interesting for other people who might not be aware of that. But our top disruptors to the future of education sector was kind of the premise of our last report before this most recent one. So our 2023 study was about the disruptors impacting the future of education. I remember one of the slides or the pages in that report is one I still use to this day when I go out and speak to schools, is we ask teachers, what do you think are the biggest disruptors to the future of education? And I guess it's not entirely surprising that amongst the sample of teachers, they selected teacher burnout as the number one that's on the hearts and minds of most teachers. But I know that it's come up in a lot of different studies that we've done. That was followed by attracting and retaining teachers. And some of the other things we were testing was, you know, the introduction of artificial intelligence into the classroom and into the education kind of pedagogy landscape. We looked at navigating, you know, student gender identity, student well-being. We looked at the deregulation of curriculum. We kind of were testing all these different disruptors that teachers were kind of, we were asking them to rank. As you think about, I guess, the future, Mark, and some of these challenges that schools are facing in so many different areas and ways, you know, different lenses, and as you speak to educational leaders, especially, I guess, at a strategic level, like at boards, what are some of the challenges that you're hearing from schools in that conversation that they're saying, yeah, this is what our school community is facing? What are some of those themes and trends that you seem to be hearing kind of consistently from that sector?
Well, student wellbeing is a big one, and how can we not just manage the education of young people, but their well-being, their resilience, their mental health, their physical health as well. And that's why we're seeing a rise, well, particularly in the independent schools, in the K-12 education. It's one of the key reasons we found in our research that parents are choosing a non-government school is because they want that pipeline for their child from when they begin right through to when they finish school, rather than have to move schools. So, and that's part of that well-being side of it. And the more that schools can support the children, the students, in terms of that well-being, in terms of that career support, that guidance, that development of the character skills and the inner fortitude and adaption amidst times of, you know, great change, the more we're equipping that next generation to thrive in their lives and develop those life and character skills. So that's a key issue. The well-being of teachers as well is a big one, and they were the first 2 points that you mentioned there, Ash, about the staff burnout and attraction and retention. And that's why a lot of schools now are looking at even developing teacher development pipelines, bringing or being part of the education, the teacher training programs, so that they can develop their own pipeline of staff, because it's an increasingly competitive environment to get and keep staff. We found in our research that the longer the staff member had been with the school, the more likely they were to say that they've considered leaving the profession in the last 2 years. The 10 plus or 11 years plus were the most likely to say they've considered leaving. So really looking after the experienced staff, giving a bit more flexibility there where we can, ensuring that we're developing a pipeline of new staff. All of these are going to be key. And there's another big disruptor here, and that is just the commercialization of the sector. Even the non-government schools that have always been non-profit. But if we look broader at the education landscape, we've got growth in after-school tutoring or coaching. We've got a lot of vendors that are supplying into schools now. It's a growing sector in terms of total money spent. But you've even got a couple of for-profit schools operating in Australia now. And it's sort of surprising to hear that, you know. But if we look across other sectors, you've got prisons that are run by commercial organisations. And it was many years ago that some hospitals were set up that are private hospitals or commercially run. And that's the case in the aged care sector and the carer sector more generally, and retirement living and toll roads being built and developed by commercial entities. So these areas that were once the public provision are increasingly being entered into for commercial reasons. And that is on the edges at the moment, happening in school education as well. So certainly something to be aware of.
I think it's interesting for us to advise on this, all of these insights and trends. And so much of what we do is kind of helping people get prepared for the future. That's what this whole podcast exists to do. And I guess I think it probably comes from us having an awareness of what's going on and the trends and being informed. And then we don't need to maybe fear the changes as much because we have an understanding of them, or at least how to respond. And I think that's something that we try and do for every organisation and every sector we work with, is to give them an understanding through insights and research like we've just conducted about the future of education, so that people aren't fearful of them. In terms of helping, say, school principals or boards or teachers at any kind of role, what do you often draw on, Mark, in terms of effective strategies for helping school leaders, particularly, I guess, to prepare and navigate these changes? Because I guess even the word disruptor, it can have a negative connotation, and there is a lot. And I said at the very top of this episode, the changes impacting the education sector are unparalleled. And I guess for leaders in that sector, they're like, gosh, it's a hard task. But we don't want people to walk away feeling like they're helpless or discouraged, but hopefully encouraged by an understanding of the trends. So I would say understanding of the trends. Do you have any other strategies or things that you encourage, you know, school leaders to keep in mind when they are thinking about responding to some of these changes?
Well, to be really aware of the community expectations, that's the broader community as well as the parental community. And this is true of a government school or a non-government school, just to understand the customer, if we want to use marketing language, because parents feel pretty empowered. They've got a lot of choice. They're choosing the local government school for a reason. If they're not happy there, they'll look to an independent school or a Catholic school, or maybe they'll go the other way. But But whichever sector they've chosen, they have their expectations, and they're looking clearly to see whether that school is delivering the needs of their child. And that's about quality education. But we found it's also about the broader holistic education that they're looking for. It's about the worldview and values and whether that resonates with their own particular values. It's about the quality of the teaching, but even the facilities that comes into play now. We found that a focus on the character formation, the leadership development of the children is important, and co-curricular or extracurricular activities, developing them broadly in life is also what they look for. So I think schools need to be aware that it's a contested landscape, that it's more competitive, that parents are more empowered, and that we can't just run a school and expect everyone to sort of fit into that. But that consultation, that understanding, that adaption to the changing expectations is important. Not compromising on the values or the purpose or the foundations of a school, but being aware of the expectations of the parents and sometimes the changing context in which we operate. I think all of that is going to help us run great schools, and regardless of sector and regardless of location or focus, really bring about those good outcomes. And there's been some very notable public situations recently where maybe school boards or executive leadership through strategy processes have headed off in a particular direction that's been at odds with the parents or the broader student body, and it hasn't gone down well. Now, in the past, people might have backed in the leaders and just trusted the process, but not anymore. So I think that consultation, that engagement, that understanding, that being aware of the context and really delivering great value education is so important today.
Mm. And as we think about these different disruptors that are at play, Mark, what kind of opportunities do you believe are emerging for the education sector? And again, just building off the last question, you know, as we talk about disruptors and change and mega trends, I guess with any of those, there are challenges, but there's also opportunities. So what do you see as some of those, I guess, more positive insights, or what could the sector look like in the future that will be, you know, more positive, say, than it is today?
Well, schools should really embrace what actually they're doing, but be clear on that and broadly communicate that they're shaping the future. They're directly shaping that next generation. And increasingly, through those 13 years of school education, plus a few years prior and a few years post, they're building a foundation of a workforce and community leaders and change makers of the emerging generation. And that's... there's very few sectors that can say that they not only influence the future, but they're building the future. They're directly shaping that future. And that's so important. And all the more, as I mentioned, some of those other organizations that used to also be developing youth or communities have fallen away a little bit. I would say, therefore, that they can probably expand on that into the future. Already now, we're seeing schools move into some of that early learning center role, that childcare type role where they're developing students even pre-kinder. We're seeing year 13 programs and even tertiary programs, particularly around education for teachers that I mentioned, that schools are now delivering. We're seeing schools run programs for parents, helping them understand how to parent in a digital world, or how to assist your child deal with perhaps screen challenges that they might face. So sometimes the development of the parents and the broader community and offering value and input there is so important. And that's a role that professional educators, I think, have. And therefore, the leader in a school can have that not only longitudinal impact over many generations and into the future, but the breadth impact as they shape not just the current students, but the parents, those others in the families, in the school community, and then the broader community as well. So I take a high view of school education. I think that they're in a privileged position to impact, to leverage, to transform society like very few other institutions. And if they really embrace that, I think the impacts they can have are even greater than what we currently see.
Yeah, I think it's a really exciting profession, even though it's undergoing a lot of changes, as so many other industries are, and we know that teachers are burnt out, but it's such a noble profession as well, and they do teach future leaders, future prime ministers, future amazing citizens, the impact is incredible. And we saw that even in the research as well, in terms of what draws people to the profession, what keeps them in the profession, even though that attraction and retention challenge is there, that people are choosing the sector, not for the work-life balance, but for the impact they can have on the next generation, which is really exciting. So shout out to all the educators who are listening. I guess leads me to another question that I wanted to ask you, Mark, based on our conversations with teachers and educational leaders. What insights can you share about their experiences and perspectives on these changes that are happening? We talked a little bit about the perspective that teachers have from our disruptors research around their acknowledging that teacher burnout is kind of here, and attracting and retaining teachers needs to be given focus. But any other reflections on the insights, I guess, from those teacher perspectives on some of these changes we've talked about today?
Well, yeah, I mean, to really look after the staff, both teaching and non-teaching, because, you know, they're the key factor that parents will make decisions on. Prospective parents are very influenced by the discussion with other of their peers, and when they get a recommendation for a school, it comes about because of great experience or connection with the staff, not just facilities. Everyone goes on a school tour and maybe susses out what the availability is of various options and what the campus is like, but it's the teachers that are key. So I think, you know, looking after the staff is key. We found pre-pandemic that teachers had perhaps more work-life balance and better non-monetary rewards than maybe their commercial colleagues, because they generally worked school hours and maybe a little bit before and after, and they got those school holidays, and they probably travelled a bit less because the schools are more local to where they were living. But these days, their commercial colleagues are more likely doing a bit more work from home and have more flexibility than even teachers. So I think that schools have to work hard on the work-life balance side for teachers, on the flexibility where they can. Teaching is more of a place-bound employment type than the other knowledge economy professions, where they can perhaps work from home. But we are seeing options where teachers are doing maybe a 0.8 load in the classroom in a given week, so 4 days a week in the classroom, but one day with the admin or other support roles, they're able to do that remotely, like some of their non-teaching colleagues. We're seeing opportunities to get further learning as teachers and so progress up the leadership pathway and the earnings pathway as well. We're seeing teachers take on those leadership responsibilities. We found in this study that the majority of teachers say they are looking for a leadership pathway and even through to maybe an assistant principal role. Interestingly, they were quite more likely to say assistant principal than principal, because they want to be in a support role but not prepared to perhaps fully take on that key principal role. But the point there is that if we can offer the training, the development, the support, the flexibility, and a career pathway for teachers, we're far more likely to retain them long term, which is, you know, what the profession needs.
Yeah, absolutely. It's that kind of workplace culture piece, I think, which every school leader needs to be thinking about, and I think every leader of every organisation needs to be thinking about, but particularly I think for a sector that we rely so heavily, like you said, on teachers who are in the classroom with the students and just looking after them. And that's what we kind of saw from this research, I think, and previous iterations of it, in terms of, yeah, the expectation that teachers do have on their leaders and their schools to look after them, and in a time where there is, like we talked about, a lot more pressure being placed on teachers for a range of, you know, more greater and complex student challenges, let alone learning and all of that else, that, you know, the leadership and the mentoring that goes on in the classroom and around it is so important for the emerging generation, and teachers do an amazing job at that, but they also need to be looked after themselves as well, which I think has definitely come through various iterations of study. So a great reminder to end the chat today on, Mark. Thanks so much for, yeah, always investing into the education sector and leading our team and encouraging us to do that. And thank you for your insights today.
Thanks, Ash. Great to chat.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, including our latest Future of Education study, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com for a range of different resources. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.